Look, y'all, Jesus is about to get a receipt from God for Calvary. Let's go in. Let's go in. Hi there. Thank you for joining us today. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for his life, his death, his burial, his resurrection. We pray that his word that's already blessed will change someone's heart. Forgive us for our sins. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's look at right now Luke 24 and 7. And it says, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. Just want to discuss for a minute the resurrection. Tiberius is the emperor. Herod Antipas is the tetrarchs of Galilee and Perea. Pilate is the Roman governor of Judea. Anna and Caiaphas is the ruling high priest. Luke wrote this book from Rome during Paul's imprisonment there, and he addresses it to Theophilus. Luke was primarily an evangelist, though he was a physician by trade. He was a close friend and companion of Paul, and probably the only Greek of Antioch in northern Syria, now called Turkey, who is an author of any part of the New Testament. He's from a form of Judaism that combined Jewish religious tradition with elements of Greek culture called Hellenistic. He wants Theophilus to be assured and firmly established in the truths of the gospel. Men needed a vivid picture of the Savior to strengthen their faith in the reality of the great truths of the gospel, such as the incarnation, the true deity, the true humanity, the perfect life, the atoning death, the glorious resurrection, and the promised return of Jesus. For the Bible says, every man that had this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he, Christ, is pure. Only when the life and mission of the Saviors are preserved, a living reality in the mind and heart, can the transforming power of his grace become effective in our life. And so you know how the story went. After Jesus cried with a loud voice, and he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. You remember the centurion saw what was done, and he glorified God, saying, certainly this was a righteous man. The people, they came together to that night, beholding the things which were done, went home in deep sorrow. All of the acquaintance, you remember, and the women that followed him from Galilee stood afar off beholding these things. You remember Joseph of Arimathea? He went unto Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. He took it down. He wrapped it in linen and laid it in the sepulcher, the burial vault. For the Bible says the law required that the bodies of those hung should not remain suspended during the night. Crucifixion was unknown, and those hung would immediately expire. The crucifixion is a painful and slow means of execution, which the Romans adopted from the Phoenicians. In the punishment by crucifixion, life was lengthened out to 4, 5, or 8 days. The Jews requested their legs might be broken to hasten their death. Since the victim could no longer raise himself up on the nails through his feet in order to allow himself to to breathe. He said, break my legs. That's what the request was. Every Sabbath had a preparation which began at the ninth hour, 3 p.m. Friday. That's the preceding evening. And here's what we missed. Augustus, the emperor before Tiberius, he ordered that no one shall give bail or surety on the Sabbath, nor on the preparation day before it. The women which came with Joseph of Arimathea from Galilee, they beheld the sepulcher. The women went to their homes to prepare their own spices and perfume to prepare Jesus' body for burial. It was a rush interment. Yes, yes. They rested the Sabbath day according to the commandments. It was called a high day because that year the feast of the Passover commenced on the Sabbath. Yeah, the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread fell that year on the Sabbath, making it a high festival. No one could be hanging to disturb the joy of the holy time. No one could be taken down to profane the Sabbath. The Sabbath began at sunset and after sundown Saturday. The resurrection occurred on the morning of the third day after his death. Counting according to customs, part of days as days. After the resurrection, there was a great earthquake. Even before that, there was the benumbing terror which seized the guards who were watching. Yeah, there was a great earthquake. The Lord's angel, he descended from heaven and rolled the stone from the door and sat on it to reveal that the tomb was empty and Jesus had already gone. The women were not able to finish preparing the body, so they returned Sunday, the third day, with expectations crushed, expecting to finish the task that had been interrupted by the Sabbath. The Bible says, but the men, angels, they said unto the woman, why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying is a declaration, a formal announcement, a proverbial one, a famous one, an aphorism of truth and principle, saying. In Matthew, the angels appeared and rolled back the stone while the women were outside. In Mark, the women see a young man when they enter the tomb. But in Luke, they enter the tomb and find the body missing before the angels appear, as in John. There are two angelic figures, apparently to fulfill the requirement of two witnesses. For the Bible says, Deuteronomy 19:15, on the evidence of two or three witnesses, a matter shall be confirmed. The appearances of the two heavenly figures at the empty tomb in Luke links the scene to other scenes of two figures that appeared when Jesus prayed on the mountain of transfiguration. Moses and Elijah were talking with him. While the men of Galilee were gazing into the sky as Jesus ascended to heaven, two angels in the form of men stood beside them. Yeah. The Bible says, saying, how remarkable it is to hear angels quoting a whole sentence of crisis to his disciples, mentioning where it was uttered and wondering it was not fresh in their memories, as doubtless as it was in theirs. The angels at the sepulcher caused the women's memory to the words of Jesus in Galilee, saying, Son of man, son of man. The term son is used in scripture language to imply almost any kind of descent or succession or male child, offspring. Son of David is Jesus' Jewish name. The messianic fulfillment of the prophecy of the seed of David, the long-awaited deliverer by people who were seeking mercy and healing. You remember blind men said, Son of David, have mercy on us. As the son of David, he is subject to time and to handling and to genealogical descent. Yeah, Son of David is his Jewish name. All the nations of the earth be blessed. I will set thy seed after thee, Solomon, but ultimately Jesus Christ. I have sworn unto David, the Bible says, the fruit of thy body will I set upon thy throne. The government shall be upon his shoulder. The rod out of the stem of Jesse. Two blind men followed him, crying out, Thy son of David, have mercy on us. He shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. I'm talking about the lion of the tribe of Judah. Revelation called him the bright and morning star. Yes, his Jewish name. But the title, Son of God, expresses the deity of the Lord Jesus as distinguished from his humanity, but to his original relationship to the Father as he was in his pre-existence before his assumed humanity. Son of God, the reference is not to the incarnation or miraculous conception of Christ, but to his oneness with God in glory that he had with the Father before the world was created. The Son of God appeared for the purpose of undoing the work of the devil. For Luke 4:41, I heard that demons also came from many. And the Bible says, whoever believes this Son of God believes the record that God gave of his Son. Whosoever confesses this Son of God, God dwelleth in him and he in God. John says, these things I have written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life. The Bible says, and we know that the Son of God is come and hath given us an understanding that we may know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, and even in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. The Bible says, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. In other words, be firm to the faith that we profess. Son of God, he does not bear this title in consequence of his resurrection and exaltation to the Father's right hand. No, 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 no. This is a title of nature and not of office. It denotes Jesus' equality with his Father. It inserts Jesus' true and proper divinity before his incarnation. But in our scripture, the angels talked about the Son of Man. Son of Man emphasizes Ezekiel's humanity and weakness and reminded him that he was dependent on the Spirit enabling power to fulfill his ministry. But here in this text, the name Son of Man links Jesus to the earth and to his mission. He was truly man and subject to the infirmities of man. In Luke, the key words are Son of Man. The key verse is Luke 19 and 10. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Son of Man is a title of Christ assumed by himself in his humiliation. Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified. The Son of Man must undergo great sufferings and be rejected by the elder chief priests and scribes and be killed. The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into human hands. The Son of Man, the Son of Man will be handed over to the Gentiles, and he will be mocked and insulted and spat upon. And after that, after they have flogged him, they will kill him. The angel said, must be delivered into the hands of sinful men. You remember? Friday, Jesus spends time in Bethany with Mary, Martha, Lazarus, and a woman anointed his feet. You know, they caught the tears in bottles back then. Sabbath was spent in traditional fashion with friends. Sunday, he rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. Monday, he cleansed the temple, then healed the blind and the lame. Tuesday, he evaded the trap set by the priests at the temple. That afternoon, he taught in parables and warned the people against the Pharisees on the Mount of Olives. Wednesday, Judas and the religious leaders plotted to have him arrested and killed. Peter and John was directed to an upper room to prepare the Passover meal. Thursday evening, Jesus returns to the city to eat the last Passover with his own. And out to the Mount of Olives, Peter's denials were predicted. Yes, Jesus, Friday, 1 a.m., Jesus surrendered his will at Gethsemane. Judas betrayed him and 600 Roman soldiers, along with priests, scribes, and elders, and the Sanhedrin arrested him. There was the conveyance to the priest's house, Caiaphas' house. You remember that. 2 a.m., there was the preliminary examination before Annas in the presence of Caiaphas. 3 a.m., there was an examination before Caius and the Sanhedrin, which unofficially took place. About 5 a.m., there was the legal verdict of the Sanhedrin in the hall of Gazit. Then the first examination before Pilate at the palace. But 5:30 a.m., there was the examination before Herod. Herod questioned Jesus, but Jesus answered him nothing. The chief priests and scribes accused Jesus. Herod and his soldiers made fun of Jesus and insulted him and dressed him in a gorgeous robe and sent him back to Pilate, and they became friends. 6:30 a.m., although Pilate found no fault in Jesus and nothing deserving of death by him, they cried out, "Away with this man and release unto us Barabbas, Barabbas, that they required that Jesus be crucified, and Pilate gave sentence. Pilate handed Jesus over to the religious leaders to do what they wanted with him. Some soldiers grabbed Simon of Cyrene, and they put the cross on him to carry behind Jesus. You remember the story. 7 a.m., the soldiers marked Jesus the second time and crucified him at 9 a.m. until he left his spirit in his father's custody. At 3 p.m., Euthymius, Paulus, Quinoa, and one other were the executioners of the sentence. Longinus, who with a spear pierced Jesus' side, later said, with those with him who I just named, truly, this must be the Son of God. But you know, the Bible says, ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? Isaiah said, but who had believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Gabriel prophesied to Daniel the Messiah would be cut off. Isaiah said he was cut out of the land of the living. He had poured out his soul unto death. Jesus said, oh, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Mark said he was numbered with the transgressors between Dismas and Augustus, the 19th of Tiberius. And so the Bible said, and be crucified. And the third day rise again. After the resurrection, there was a great earthquake. The Lord angels descended from heaven and rolled the stone from the door and set on it to reveal that the tomb was empty and that Jesus was already gone, as I've already said. But 5 a.m., Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, and Salome, probably with other women, they started for the sepulcher in twilight. Mary Magdalene goes before the others and returned at once to Peter and John. 5:30 a.m., her companions reached the sepulcher when the sun had risen. The angels told the women, fear not. The angels told the women to go tell the disciples, meet Jesus in Galilee. 6 a.m., another party, among whom is Joanna, these women Jesus had healed. She followed his disciples, provided for them as they traveled in Galilee. The two young men asked them, why seek ye the living among the dead? 6:30 a.m., John stooped down and saw the clothes in the tomb. Then Peter went in the sepulcher. Then John went in and believed. Disciples, they went home. Mary stooped down and seen an angel at the head and at the feet. About the same time, the company of women carrying their tidings to the apostles. 7 a.m., the Lord reveals himself to Mary Magdalene. Go to thy brothers and say to them, I ascend unto my Father. Not long after this, he reveals himself to the company of women returning to the sepulcher, who the angels charged to tell the brethren, go to Galilee. 4 through 6 p.m., Christ appears to two disciples on the way to Emmaus. Have I got a witness? Yes. Yes. 4 p.m., Christ appears to Peter. 8 p.m., Christ appears to the 11 in the upper room, Thomas being absent. He appears to his disciples, including Thomas, on the next Sunday, told Thomas, "Blessed are they that have not seen and have yet believed." He appeared to seven disciples beside the Sea of Galilee, Peter, Thomas, Nathanael, the sons of Zebedee, and two others disciples. He appeared to more than 500 of the brethren and sisters at the same time, 1 Corinthians 15:6. He appeared to James, the Lord's brother, his own brother, 1 Corinthians 15:7. He appeared to 11 disciples on the mountain in Galilee, Matthew 28:16-20. He appeared at the time of his ascension, Acts 1:3-9. He appeared to Stephen. Stephen saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God, Acts 7:55-56. He shined round about Paul on Damascus Road, told Paul, "I am Jesus whom thou persecutest." Paul said, "When it pleased God to reveal his son in me, I went to Arabia preparing for the ministry." While Paul prayed in Jerusalem temple, he was in a trance, and Paul saw Jesus say unto him, "Make haste and get thee quickly out of Jerusalem, for they will not receive thy testimony concerning me." While Paul was in prison in Caesarea, the Lord stood by him and said, "Be of good cheer, Paul, for thou hast testified of me in Jerusalem, so must thou bear witness also at Rome." John was in the isle called Patmos in the spirit of the Lord on the Lord's day, and he heard behind him a great voice as a trumpet saying, "I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen, and has the keys of hell and of death." And I heard that he declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection of the dead. Christ was delivered up because of our offenses. And he was raised because of our justification. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. And at the second coming of Christ, the life that's now hid in Christ shall then appear with him in glory. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will give you life. Give it to your mortal bodies through his spirit that dwells in you. For since by one man death came, by one man came also resurrection from the dead. Praise be to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God of our Father, of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy, he's begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We've got love of the Father. We've got redemption from the Son. We've got sanctification from the Holy Spirit. We've got justification. We've got present day power. We've got strength. We've got fruitful labor. Oh, I'm glad. Oh, I'm glad. Oh, 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 I'm glad. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, he's all right. Yes. Oh, he's all right. Yeah, Lord. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Hey, yes. Oh, 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 yes. Hey, 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 hey. Ooh, I like that. Yes, I like that, man. Yeah. Look, I'm going to take this opportunity once again to invite you to 521 West 65th Street, where the Reverend Antonio Jr. is pastor. Big Zion Missionary Baptist Church, 521 West 65th Street, 11 o'clock on Sundays. Come be with us in Jesus' name.